It's 8 o'clock, and friends, welcome once again formally to our sixth session and sixth conference on the whole series of evangelizing Irish culture. And tonight we have something special in store for you and for all of us, because we're talking about music and mission. And as we all know, music is a beautiful gift from God. It's a medium that carries the word of God. It carries the Holy Spirit. It has the ability to reach hearts in a way that words can never do. And I'm delighted to introduce to you today, Mr. Steve Warner. Steve is a good friend of mine for many years. We met in Rome, and Steve has been here with his wife, Michelle, in Ireland at University Church Stephen's Green for the last number of years. And he has done tremendous work in the area of ministry, music, and evangelization and liturgy. And one thing I know about Steve is that he has passionate love for the Irish people and for the Irish church. And that comes out in everything he says, he writes, and he does. So we're delighted to have him here this evening. And I know he's going to do a fantastic job and do a wonderful presentation in reminding us of the potential of music as a means for evangelization and mission. So just before I hand over to Steve, I'm going to just say a little prayer on this beautiful feast day of St. Teresa of Avila. We pray through her intercession for our conference here this evening that it will be successful. And I pray with her and ask her to intercede for the Lord, for our country and for our church at this time, that nothing in her own prayer, nata te turbe, nothing would disturb us, but that God alone will be our strength, and that people will turn back to his love and to his mercy in this time of pandemic and in this time of crisis. We make this our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Steve, my friend, all over to you.
Thank you very much, Billy, and thank you for that wonderful introduction. Just a reminder to everybody to probably, at least at this point, mute your screens so that we don't have any dogs barking or other percussive moments that could interfere at this point. So anyway, so thank you, Billy. Thank you for the invitation. It's really wonderful to be a collaborator on this month-long wonderful kaleidoscope of looking at ministerial and mission-oriented themes. So I will begin. Years ago in the United States, as I was growing up and being a child of my own times, and that would be the crazy 1960s and 1970s in America, I went to religious education classes every week. They called it CCD, the Confraternity of Christian Doctrine.
Yeah.
Looking back on that experience, the foundations that were handed over to me, the stories that were told, and the music that I was taught, it occurs to me that very, very little of it prepared me for the path into the adult faith community of the church. I say this by way of introduction to tonight's conversation on mission and music. What is the purpose? What is the purpose of sacred music in the liturgy? And as well, what role does it play in the church's understanding of evangelization, mission, and catechesis? Looking back on my own catechetical formation and the music of those early years, I was alarmed at how paltry was the repertoire. Most of the songs celebrated friendship or social justice, but oftentimes there was not even a single reference to Jesus. Now remember, I'm speaking about the United States here, let alone biblical references. One of my CCD courses taught me not from scriptural sources, but from the Broadway musical, West Side Story. Now, I love Lenny Bernstein, but it was a bit of a stretch to move from Tonight on the Balcony to trying to figure out what Jesus was saying to me. Anyway, these were published resources and not just some wayward catechist's agenda. I bring this personal experience up because years later, I am absolutely convinced that sacred music has a unique and powerful role in shaping the faithful, in handing over their tradition and evangelizing, especially young people. But before I become a talking head, let's just stop for a minute. We're actually going to start with a piece of sacred music. I'm joined tonight by my colleague here at University Church, Dominique Cunningham. And the first piece we're going to share is one Ireland might know, a sampling from the scriptural song, Set Your Heart on the Higher Gifts. So I'm going to pull out my guitar right here, and here we have it. Second, it teaches scripture, summarizing the message of chapters 12 and 13 from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. And third, it names the theological virtues, faith, hope, and love, and naming love as the most important. Sacred music should have a certain attraction if it can teach well. The tune should stay in the ear and touch the heart. But there is a careful balance to be had here. Some pieces can be written in so simplistic a manner that they are trite after the first or second hearing. And trite has proven, the word trite, or the genre trite, has proven time and again that it doesn't stand up to the test of time. A piece like the one we just shared, or any of the others, hopefully, that we'll do tonight, are known for their simplicity and their authenticity. They don't rely on pop music conventions. They have an ability to teach to all ages, young and old. And that point about teaching to the young and the old is a critical one. Here, I believe, is one of the great mistakes of teaching the faith in the United States in the 1960s and 1970s. In an effort to be relevant, the church watered down its tradition, at least it did for me. I was handed over bunnies and butterflies on Easter, sidestepping the greatest mystery of all, Christ rising from the dead. Faith became childish, not childlike. And the vast majority of the faithful were walking around, and perhaps still are, with a preteen notion of all things spiritual. I think we do a disservice to our children and to our young adults especially if we don't acknowledge that faith is an adult thing, something to be brought into, drawn into, a real, encouraging, tangible way of living that helps us through all the confounding and celebratory moments of loss, betrayal, joy, transition, and accomplishment as well. When a young person is brought into the Jewish faith, what do? They read from the Torah, and they do so in front of the adult assembly. It is clear that they are being introduced into a journey of adult faith. But this is the first step. The adults witness to this, and they will accompany the maturing children in their journey. Do we give our youth, through the gift of song and through the gift of our example, a glimpse of what awaits them as adults? The next piece that I want to share with you actually comes directly from Ireland, from Father Liam Lawton, his beautiful setting of Psalm 16, Ghrá Thú Ahearna. Testament text, set your heart on the higher gifts, to an Old Testament psalm, Ghrá Thú Ahearna. But both pieces have quite a few things in common. They're singable and therefore memorable and repeatable. They both paraphrase but very closely align themselves to the given texts. And finally, both songs have been deemed by people other than the composers that they're worthy of publication and distribution to a wider audience. In other words, they've made it through the editorial process, both theological and musical, and they've passed the test. Every one of these elements is important in the passing on of the tradition. The next piece to share also employs elements from Ireland, but unlike the antiphonal song, Set Your Heart, or the psalm setting, Ghrá Thú Ahearna, this piece is a hymn. It employs a poetic text by Jan Struther, and it joins with one of Ireland's most memorable tunes, the tune called Slain. Hymns are usually a combination of text and tune, and this one is remarkable for several reasons. You've probably heard this tune before, perhaps with the text, Be Thou My Vision. Dominique is now going to sing two of the verses of Lord of All Hopefulness.
Give my
This is just a sampling of the lyrics. We didn't use all four verses here. But I consider this hymn, this text, to be beautifully evocative, one of really compelling integrity. Dominique sang the first and the last verses, the first having to do with the break of the day, the last with the end of the day, and the human activities associated with each one. The verses she didn't sing refer to the noon of the day, that is, our labors, and the eve of the day, our homing. The entire text functions on two levels. It speaks of the passage of the day, but it also reminds us of the passage of an entire life at one and the same time. Dawn, noon, evening, and the end of each day are an analogy to our birthing, our labor, our sunset, and our own passing. It is powerful poetry, simple, breathtaking, and true, and it appeals to all ages. The church, our youth, our elderly, our parents, they deserve such richness to help them with their life of faith. And isn't it remarkable in this hymn that there's actually this glorious arch, from beginning of the tune to the end of the tune, that actually mirrors our own life as well, from our birth all the way through the zenith of our life with our productive years and to our elder years as well. It's just one of the most perfect hymns that I could ever imagine. Now to turn to a text very close to our own hearts here at Newman University Church, the poem Lead Kindly Light by St. John Henry Newman, our most recent canonized Irish saint and builder of the very church we are broadcasting from. Just a few days ago, we celebrated the one-year anniversary of Newman's canonization, so it seems quite appropriate to share this piece of sacred music with you. I'm going to ask Dominique, because we're doing very well with time now, and this is a beautiful piece, to do all the verses. So, and I know you know them, right? So here we are with the tune, Lead Kindly Light.
Lead me on, Lord, lead me on.
passage from the book of Revelations. It's in chapter 21, and it says, "See, I make all things new." Such is the spirit of sacred music, always looking for new ways to teach, to pass along truths and insights and stories of those who have gone before us. The text of this past piece that we just did was written by Newman more than 100 years ago, but the musical setting that we just accompanied the poetry to is little more than a decade old. All things made new. It brings birth of poetry of the saint together in a new way. Lest we forget the power of music, just a few licks on the guitar for a moment, just to remind us all of what a few phrases can do in terms of bringing us to a space, to a memory, to a season. Just one of these, for instance. Have a listen for a moment, and where does it bring you? You know exactly where you are. You're getting ready for Christmas, and there are four candles in front of you. And whatever family memories you might have or parish memories, a simple maybe two measures will bring you to that. Here's another one. The last one was from Advent. This one, a different time, different season. Set of memories, even different direction, obviously, to the Mother of God. So we're dealing with a very powerful teaching tool here, and we have so much rich repertoire. How much of that can we put into the hands of our faithful and let that be the rich tradition that we can hand over, especially to our young people as they come deeper and deeper into the adult faith that we're passing on to them. Now finally, one last piece. And I must admit, we're having, as all things do, a little bit of a glitch here. We had prepared a series of images, but I won't apologize for that. We can't do it, right?
You won't let me share it.
Yeah. So we were hoping to give you on this next piece, which is actually by Teresa of Avila. The text is, "Christ has no body now with yours," with this whole wonderful montage of first responder pictures. So as you're hearing this text tonight now, think in your mind of the images that you've seen in the Irish Times or in the Independent of all the healthcare workers that have literally risked their lives for the last 6 months on our own behalf. Think of all of those people, the sacrifices that have been made, even in the line of ministry with people like priests with visors on handing out communion. All these different images that we now have as part of our collective history of the last 6 months of living through a pandemic. Think of those images as we're delivering this next text, which is by the saint, the text coming from Teresa of Avila, and we're celebrating, obviously, the feast of this doctor of the church today in the Catholic Church. So here it is right now. "Christ has no body now but yours."
No hands but yours to hear the
once again, here in this presentation, this song, is just with guitar and a vocalist. The goal is to teach the tradition with simple integrity, passing on the words of a doctor of the church and a spiritual heroine. The score doesn't need to be complicated, it just needs to provide a window framing the text. Music here, as always, should be a servant of the word, a servant of the tradition. So in our journey, we've actually covered a lot of ground. We've talked about evangelization, the ability to call people into the church with a strong message and with memorable tunes. We've spoken of the critical task of teaching our tradition to young people in ways that can serve to introduce them to the adult faith community. We've moved from a New Testament canticle, Set Your Heart on the Higher Gifts, to an Old Testament psalm, Mograhu Ahirna, to hymnody, Lord of All Hopefulness, to contemporary compositions like Christ Has No Body Now But Yours and Lead Kindly Light. But throughout, we've kept an eye on teaching the tradition to all ages with simple integrity. Now, before I hand it back to Father Billy and open up to what I'm sure is going to be lots of fun questions, I want to thank Dominique for coming down from Newry tonight to sing with me this evening, and the person behind the cameras and the lights and all the good things that are going on to help that, and that's my colleague as well, Katherine Dunn. So, Billy, back to you down in Enniscorthy. I presume that's where you are right now.
It certainly is, Steve, and thank you so much to you, to Dominique, and to the other lady there whose Katherine. Name escapes me right now.
Katherine.
Katherine, yeah. Katherine and Dominique, thank you so much for that wonderful, I suppose, exposition or synthesis, Steve, of music, of prayer, of scripture, and of faith. And this is precisely what we're talking about here tonight in how to maximize these resources that we have as a church to pass on the gift of faith to others and also strengthen our own in the process.